Before we start tonight, any questions on our previous, we're starting part number two tonight, so any questions on part number one, the exposition? All right, tonight we're starting part number two, Biblical Parenting, using John MacArthur's book, Successful Christian Parenting. So, Jeff, could you start us in prayer tonight as we look at, we're going to try to maybe get two chapters done tonight. We'll just see how it goes.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you. Thank you for this opportunity, Lord. I pray that as we sit here tonight, that we will learn, listen, and work at applying what your word has to say about raising our children. We love you, Lord. We ask this in your name. Amen.
All right. John MacArthur gives chapter one of his book, the title, Shade for Our Children. Shade Your Children. He quotes this Chinese proverb, one generation plants the trees and another gets the shade. Now that makes sense to some of us that have done some planting of trees. We've got about, I think, 40 blue spruces that we plant along the property line. And my son-in-law, Brian, says they're my anti-evangelistic border. That I'm boarding myself up against my neighbors. I said, no, actually, it's full of evangelism because that way we'll have better relationships with them. But, and we, you know, they're there for windbreak and, you know, for privacy and that kind of thing. But often we look at one another, we look at our little trees, and we say, whoever buys the house when we die are going to get the advantage of them. And that's the idea
here. What you do, even as grandparents and parents, is a shade for your children and even your grandchildren. And I believe it can even go further than that. I often remember, of course, somebody mentioned prayer once, and it was Thanksgiving and things he thanks the Lord for every day. And one of them was godly home. And just about every day, I thank God for the godly home, the godly example that I had. We take that so much for granted because not everybody has that. Not everybody had that. And that was my shade. Now, I don't agree with everything, but boy, the godliness, the priorities, the examples that were there were spot on. And that gave me a great foundation to begin to build on. The idea here is that our parents and grandparents, as I said, provide us with shade. Their ethics, their perceptions, their priorities, their right and wrong, their sense of moral duty, spiritual commitment was shade for us. Obviously, some people didn't get as much shade as others in that regard, and you had to start maybe in some cases starting that yourself. This quote, What we desperately need is a return to the biblical principles of parenting. Christian parents don't need new shrink wrap programs. They need to apply and obey consistently the few simple principles that are clearly set forth for parents in God's Word. And building upon that, before I go to those three, he mentioned three, I'm going to add two more. The biblical solution to parenting simply is the biblical foundation of marriage and of parents, father and mother. We look in our society today, and that's been blown, you know, it's treated by the world that a single parent is just as ideal as the dual parent mode. And most single parents that I talk to would say, no. Whether it's a father or whether it's a mother. God designed mom different, designed God, dad different, in order to give the children that well-balanced everything they needed in that home. And, of course, marriage. Now you can have children without, of course, not only being married, but same-sex couples are now getting children. And so we see that God's principle foundation of marriage, one man, one woman, having children after marriage, is something that probably without doubt we are starting to be outnumbered on that. I remember even years ago when my wife was in the maternity ward in New Zealand. She was the only one there that was married. So I can imagine how much more we are outnumbered in that regard. But that needs to be there, that foundation. Those biblical principles, and some of these are exactly what we've looked at the last 3 weeks. Deuteronomy 6:7, teach your children God's word and principles. Don't depend upon the church and Sunday school. Hopefully they're going to come alongside and they're going to complement, they're going to confirm what you've been teaching all week is the idea. Number two, Proverbs 23:13-14, discipline them when they do wrong. Colossians 3:21, don't provoke them to anger. I've added these two, Ephesians 6:1-2 that we looked at. Teach them to be obedient and respectful. They don't come obedient. They just don't come that way. So if they're going to be that way, you've got to instruct and you've got to enforce that. And number five, Ephesians 6:4, train and admonish them in the Lord. They need that training and it needs to be in the Lord. Again, pointing them not so much to obeying you as obeying God. By obeying me, you what? Are obeying God, and that's even more important. There seems to be an abandonment, as I've just mentioned, of previous shade tree planters. Children are permitted many times, I've seen over the years, to make decisions they simply are not mature enough to do and to express themselves without any kind of discipline. Often I have made the comment, parents, be parents. Parents and parenting is much more than simply providing food, shelter, and clothing for your children, okay? It goes far beyond that. In fact, I think that's sort of the smaller part of it. Besides today, you don't have to work too hard at that. The government will do it for you. But parenting has to do with the training and nurturing of the heart and of the mind and preparing them far more than even just food, shelter, and clothing. Shade your children. Now, MacArthur mentions, and they're in your book, four principles that will help us to be shade tree planters. Number one, see your children as a blessing, not a hardship. See your children as a blessing, not a hardship. And we see in Scripture, they're viewed as indeed blessings from God. Genesis 4:1, Eve gave birth to Cain. I have acquired a man from the Lord. God only gives us good gifts. And they come, children come from the Lord. Verse 25, God has appointed another seed for me. God blessed, it says, Rachel with children. Genesis 30:23, God has taken away, she said, my reproach. We know the story of Hannah. Never in Scripture are children seen as a bad thing. Never in Scripture are they seen as a curse. Never in Scripture are they seen as a punishment. They are a blessing from the Lord, and we must parent in the means in which our children know that we see and consider them as blessings. Viewed as a gift from God, Psalm 127. Verses 3 to 5. Psalm 127, 3 to 5. The Lord has done great things for us. That's verse 126. That goes good too, though. All right, 3 to 5. Behold, children are a what? Heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a what? Reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth. Happy is the man who has his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but shall speak of their enemies in the gate. And we have people in this church whose quiver is definitely full in that regard, at least by today's standards, I guess I should say. But notice here, they are a heritage of the Lord. They are considered, if you may, a reward. For children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. So children should be seen as Scripture depicts them as blessings, as rewards. and as indeed from God. Children are such a blessing when they arrive. But if we leave them exposed to the world, unshaded by the protection that they need, they will break your heart. Take an apple. Take a potato. You put it in there, leave it alone in the environment that it wasn't intended to be. What happens to that barrel of apples? What happens to that barrel of potatoes? It'll rot. So, they are indeed a blessing, but they must be nurtured. They must be trained. Secondly, consider parenting to be a joy, not a burden. Now, what's the difference? Children, a gift from God, a reward from God. The actual job of parenting, of actually doing that. I remember several times Ted Jones would say to me, you know, we give premarital counseling around here. He says, we had that down. We didn't have too many problems in adjusting to married life. He says, but boy, adjusting to parenting has been a big issue in that regard. Consider parenting to be a joy, not a burden. How can we consider parenting a joy? Okay, why is it a joy? Now, are there problems? Yes. Are there heartaches? Absolutely. But overall, in what ways can we consider parenting a joy, not a burden to bear? One, it is a gift from God. Going back to that, they're a gift. This cannot be bad. The kid can be bad. All right? Absolutely. But opportunity to train and prepare a person to serve God. That's what this is all about. I don't know about you, but winning someone to Christ, and especially I love discipling someone. It's a great joy of mine in ministry. If I enjoy discipling someone, then I should consider parenting what? A joy. Because you're discipling them to be used of God. I don't think there's any greater privilege and honor than to prepare a servant of God. And that's exactly what parenting is. Remember, we talked about them being loaned to us, and now we are parenting them and training them to be used of God. Secondly, it should be considered a joy simply because it's God's will. We're commanded to what? Rejoice when? Always. So whether it's parenting or whatever it is, but again, God has given us our children to raise them for Him. That is God's will. And as someone, and I've told you that story, said to me once, doing something very painful, doing something very difficult, doing something we both dreaded in a sense, but he said, I'm looking forward to it because this is God's will, and it's always a joy to what? Do the will of God. So this is God's will for you to parent, to train and nurture and disciple these children. We'll be looking at that in a few weeks, next week maybe. Proverbs 29:17, correct your son and he will give you rest. He will give you delight to your soul. Hebrews 12:11, of course, we looked at that under discipleship. And we just read Psalm 27, 3-5. See, or really this is 3, isn't it? Remember, okay, now this might be a little tough. Throw apples, write John MacArthur letters. This is directly from him with a couple of slants from me. And we're going to read a quote here in a minute that might bring some response. Remember that success in parenting is measured by what the parents do, not by what the child does. God places the responsibility on the parent. Even, why did it leave me? It was Eli, wasn't it? With his older kids, right? Who was held, am I the right guy? Where's my wife? Yep, she's right. Okay, I'm right. She's right. I'm right. Whatever. Okay, I get the names messed up. But, you know, a lot of people say, okay, they are, you know, remember, having our children under control and everything is a part of one of the qualifications for being a deacon and an elder. And this is what we're talking about. It's not so much what the kid does, but what the parent does. And so, therefore, once they're out of the home, I'm okay. No, you're not. Eli was held responsible because he had the power and the ability to restrain his adult children, and what? He did not. He didn't even rebuke them that we know of. So that responsibility of saying to your child, you are wrong, that's with you forever. But so is it called rebuking what? One another. So just as I should do that with my fellow brothers and sisters that I love, that continues with my children. The true measure of the Christian parents is the parent's own character. We read the verse, train up a child when he is old, he will not depart from it. God gives parents the responsibility to raise children, not school teachers, not peers, not child care workers or others, and I'm not saying any of those are wrong or evil. But, you know, I see a tendency sometimes of children, of parents, I'm going to bring them to church and let them take care of them. I have heard, even in Christian schools, when my child came to Christian Martinsville Christian, at the age of 6, they were a great kid. By the time they were 14, they were terrible. It's your fault. And they were serious as a heart attack. And I went, well, what were you doing in the meantime? We have a tendency to want to think the church, the Christian school, the counselor is going to fix it. You can bring in people to help, to assist. I often got on the phone and got some counsel. But it is still your responsibility. In regard to this, I remember one time having a bit of a detour with our children and wondering if I had disqualified myself from ministry. And I was serious as I could be. So I called up someone that I trusted and appreciated. And the questions were, okay, once I told him the situation, what did you do? And I told him everything that I did. He's good. What did the child do? I said they were very repentive, very responsive, and very much took the discipline. And at this point, then you're in control of your home. I went, oh. It's not about being bad children, because children are what? They're bad. That's what they do. So if it's about bad children, nobody is qualified. But what does the parent do to correct the badness? That's the issue. And how does the child respond in kind to that? That's the issue. Remember, a child's most important influences come from parents, not peers. Boy, that's huge. What's your thoughts of that one? How can you keep that being true? Remember, a child's most important influence comes from parents, not peers. How do you keep that, or how do you make sure that you're having more influence over your children than their peers? Especially if the peers is negative peer pressure.
Well, too, you got a lot of people that change things.
Okay.
You know, like Christians, they think about other things and they'll change your kid's mind.
Okay. How do we keep that from happening? Do you hear what he said? Sometimes other people will change our child's minds. You know, the dinner table is a great place to have dialogues. And I remember Brian and Michelle, the child come home, they were around the table and they were talking. And Lydia had been in school and she goes, and we're talking about who they're going to marry. And she says, I'm going to marry, and she named the person, and it wasn't a male, it was a female. And so Brian and Michelle said, whoa, 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 that's have a chat about this. Well, our teacher said it's okay. But they proceeded and took God's word and said, no, it's not okay. You've got to know, especially today, and especially if they are in a public school, and even sometimes a Christian school, you've got to know what's going on as a parent. And you've got to continue to know how to flush that out of what they're thinking, of how they've been influenced, of how they are maybe having their mind influenced, so that you can what? Reprogram and continue to build that relationship and to point them to God in that sense. Now, hold on. As I say this, I'll put a thing on it first here a minute. Children are taught to be what they become. Now, I know some people that have become wonderful men, a couple of men, wonderful men of God, wonderful preachers. But about 60, 70, they went off the wall. They just went. Now, I don't believe that's what he's talking about here. But what he's talking about is what they become by the time, I believe, they become adults. By the time they're about ready to leave the home. What they become under your influence, where you can control it and you're able to set the guidelines and stuff. This is MacArthur's comment. Whenever outside influences shape a child's character more than the parents have failed in their duties. It is as simple as that. What you got? It's pretty tough, isn't it? What's your thoughts on that? Now, you didn't say the way they turned out. Let's read it again. Whenever outside influences shape a child's character more than the parents have failed in their duties. Okay. Somebody got a comment? That's back to that point of making sure that you are influencing your child more than their peers. That's why it's important. What happened today? Did you have a good time with your friend? What kind of things did you talk about? Do what you can to get that out so you can see and so you know. It isn't just a matter such as peers, they're just with their peers and it rubs off. You have to become much more proactive in influencing your children to counter some of those other influences. In fact, you may want to limit the time they have on the sports team, on this or that, so that you have what? The time to do that. I remember, you know, Michelle and Crystal in the home really didn't have too many difficulties after we'd moved up here and they were teenagers, not much at all, not much trust issues. But they'd been gone, I don't know, a few evenings. And they said, can we go? And I said, no. They said, why? I said, because we'd like to have you at home. You've been gone. And so I'd like you to be home. I want to have time with you. You know, so sometimes just this idea of giving them freedom, you need to keep them in that environment so that you can continue to what? Influence, and keep programming, if you may, and keep that testimony, and especially as they become teenagers, developing a friendship as well with your children, making it fun to be at home. Can parents be fun in the teenage years? Yes. Doesn't mean it's all going to be fun, but you can be fun. You know, I was told, oh, wait until you hit the teenage years. I loved them. And yes, we had a few hiccups. Yes, we did. But for the most part, I absolutely loved the teenage years because I could talk to them and we could enjoy some conversation and things that I enjoyed doing and things I began to do that they enjoyed doing. So children are taught to be what they become. Make sure you're doing the teaching far above and beyond even teachers at school, even the peers of your friends. You want to be looking at those peers. You want to be looking at those And you want to make sure these are good influences, that you don't have to be dealing with that all the time. That takes effort. Parents are commanded to teach their children, to admonish, to discipline their children by word, as we've been teaching, and by example. Parents will be held accountable. They are given to us by God, for God, and we have been instructed in Scripture clearly how to raise them. Parenting is 24/7. Deuteronomy 6:6-7 that we spoke of in our first week, I believe it was. There are no coffee breaks. It's just not. I remember Ted said to me once, "Man, I feel like instead of a parent, I'm a referee, and that I'm always on duty." Yeah, well, that's pretty well it. And the more children you have, the more of a referee you're going to be, right, Mark? Yep. You're just, especially if you've got a whole bunch of boys, you're going to be a referee. It is a full-time responsibility. Judges chapter 2, verses 7 to 10. Judges 2, 7 to 10. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, Numbers, Judges, chapter 2. Seven to ten. So the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of the Lord, which he had done for Israel. Now Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died when he was 110 years old, and they buried him within the border of his inheritance at Timnath Heres, in the mountains of Ephraim, in the north mountain of Gash. When all the generation had been gathered to their fathers, another generation arose after them who did not know the Lord nor the work he had done for Israel. Can you imagine that? Another generation raised children after Joshua, and they understood all the miracles and all the great things that God had done. And it was one generation later, they didn't even know what God had done. Wow, terrible. Build shade trees for your children. Failed, this generation did, obviously, in their responsibilities. It happened in future generations, and I'm afraid many times that is still happening. Parents, your job is, as we said, full-time. Full-time planters of spiritual shade trees. The first step is get back on track as far as the principles. That's why we laid these down the first 3 weeks, to readjust their priorities. The heart that pants after God as a deer pants after water. Not only do you desire that for your children, but they've got to see that you truly love God, can't wait to hear from God, either in your time, you know, in the Word, or as you come to church, that you are seeking first God's kingdom, that you have a hunger and thirst after righteousness, that it bothers you when you hear a swear word, and so forth and so on. That you reject the world's philosophy. Your children must see that because you've accepted God's. MacArthur, and we'll close this part with that and get started on the next one. For parents to be derelict in their own spiritual lives is tantamount to cutting down all the shade trees for the next generation and their family. And this was, I think, really the main emphasis of our first lesson in Deuteronomy, is the first thing is you having that godliness and that desire that is sincere, that begins to plant those shade trees for our children to grab a hold of, to rest in, to know, hey, that worked for me. You know, often I would hear people talking about spanking in a derogatory way and how it hurts and ruins kids. How many of you heard that? Well, being the shade tree that my parents, I got it quite a bit. And I don't really think it hindered me all that much. So that's a shade. I could say, no, you guys are wrong. It was done, and it was done right most of the time. There was once or twice, that he didn't follow some guidelines and thinking that maybe he should have. For the most part, it was done right. So no, you can't tell me that. See, the sun was coming in, trying to blind me and say, no, that shade tree was planted, and that's what we're doing for our children. Questions, comments on lesson one? Yes. Well, again, that's part of the idea. We're trying to toughen up our kids. And I think some parents, we're going to look at that coming down the road here, that we try to make everything easy for our children. That is not a good idea. All right, next lesson. We probably will not get all the way through it, but we'll get started. And this is why we need the shade trees. These two things go together, and then the next five lessons basically are getting to work. Understand your child's greatest need. What is the problem? We've gone through this. We've hinted it quite a bit. What is the problem? Help me out. When your child are born, what's the problem? Total depravity, it's called. The theological, biblical term. What does that mean, total depravity? Sinful? What else? Very sinful. What else? Okay. All right. Look at the word total depravity. The idea is that every part of every human being is diversely affected by sin. Not only, indeed, are these two absolutely right, sinful, very sinful, every part of them. There's nothing within any human being that has ever been born that is not affected by sin. Therefore, expect your child to sin. Be ready for it. You shouldn't be shocked and caught blindsided by the fact that your child, this perfect little baby that it was when it was however old, is sinful. Our children are born with a serious, lethal, terminal birth defect. Parents, recognize your child's potential. Given free rein, every baby has the potential to become a monster. Do you believe that? Absolutely. They came into the world, these are quotes, they came into the world seeking the fulfillment of sinful fleshly desires. We have an appetite for evil and no natural thirst for God. Understand that. Your child doesn't enter the world with this appetite and this thirst for godly things and for righteousness. It is all about me. Correct? And that's the way they enter the world. Parents, you must not be afraid of correcting wrong behavior, but must do it swiftly, lovingly, and consistently, as we've been talking about. Somebody read for me nice and loudly, Psalm 58:3. This will make you look at every baby differently. Psalm 58:3. Whoa, that's pretty tough stuff. Look at that. The wicked are estranged from the womb. They go astray when they reach age 5. No. As soon as they are born, speaking lies. Can an infant lie? Tell me, give me an example of an infant lying. Okay, you ought to be a bit of an expert on this. Richard as well.
Crying like they're dying, and all of a sudden you pop the bottle in their mouth and they're just quiet.
But I'm going to, you know, not much of a baby guy, but I'll be the defense lawyer for the baby here. All right, one, they can't come up quietly and tell you, I'm hungry. It's time to eat. So it's the only thing they know to do, and that is to cry. In order, I'm talking about 6-week-old, 2-week-old babies. So come back at me. You're on the right track. Is all crying of a baby to eat sinful? Well, man, I like to be cuddled too a little bit.
And then they'll say, they weren't picked up. And, you know, maybe you just cuddled them and done all that. And
you
still do that.
Let me see. How many of you believe a child before he can talk lies? Well, all the parents got that one down. Yes. Not only are we looking at examples of it, God's word says so. That they begin to lie. Hey, that was good. I don't want to go to bed. I want to stay up. So when I cry, what does mom do? Picks me up. Because she thinks something's wrong. Now, again, that becomes a very issue of wisdom when there is something wrong. There is colic. There is other things going on. But there are times they're beginning to train you. Proverbs 22:15. Foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child. The rod of correction will drive it far from him. Left alone, leniency, absence of discipline allows your child to give the expression of his or her depravity. And they will just continue to do it. Seeing ourselves, how does God see us? And this is the next issue, and I don't know how far we'll get here. See ourselves as God sees us. We've got to get that to that point. We've got to learn to see ourselves the way God sees us. Seeing ourselves as God sees us. So how does God see us? Get your pen and paper, get your pens out, and we're going to go pretty quickly here. And this is the way God describes us. It's the way we are from his point of view. Romans 3, 9, and 13, some of you might know it, is what? None are righteous. None are righteous. You know, I heard a comment the other day, and there's conservatives, and the Republicans were really taking Joe Biden at it, and I told my wife, I cannot believe that I am defending Joe Biden. But he made the comment that 10, 15% of American population is bad. And he was getting, I said, well, really, the Bible says 100% are bad. But no, I agree with that. That's why they're doing bad things. Because they're what? Bad. But boy, we've driven that away from our, we just don't want to do that, do we? We can't call anybody bad. Well, God's word says none are righteous. That includes our children. Number two. Isaiah 64, 6, what does that say, class? Our righteousness, the way we view what we, you're probably not going to be able to read that, so you can if you want, try, if you got better glasses than I do. All our righteousness are as filthy rags. The best that I can do compared to God's standards is filthy, smelly, basically diapers. What does God call us in John? 1 John 3, 8 to 10, 5, 19, John 8, 44. We are children of who? Boy, it's not a very good picture, is it? And we're going to talk about it probably next week. It blows the self-image issue right out of the water. Ephesians 4, 18, 1 Corinthians 2, 11, it says our understanding is darkened. Our heart is deceitful and wicked. Genesis 6, 5, Jeremiah 16, 12, 17, 9, and all those others. In Genesis 6, 5, Titus 1, 15, our mind and our conscience is defiled. The will is corrupt, Isaiah 53, 6. Psalm 94, 11, our thoughts are vanity. John 3, 19, the deeds are evil. In Genesis 3 and Romans 11, we're under the curse. Take a look at this list. And how can we say that man is basically good? You hear that out there a lot today. There's good in all of us. That's not the premises from which God comes, is it? It's not the way he sees us. So we need to start there. Then seeing ourselves as God sees us, this is what we come up with. Romans 12:3. This is 2 there. We are not to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. When we see ourselves as God sees us, then we're going to be humble in our thinking. We're not going to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. Romans 12, 16, we are not going to be wise in our own conceits. Romans 8, 8, we are unable to please God in the flesh. We recognize, we understand all of that first part that we talked about. And therefore, if I'm going to please God, I can't do that in and of myself. I need Him in my life. And I need Him empowering me. And as I put my faith in Him, then I'm able to please Him. There is nothing that I have that is pleasing to Him outside of me putting faith in Him. 2 Corinthians 3, 4 to 5. And such trust we have through Christ to Godward, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. When we look at that first list, we recognize, well, then what good am I? And remember, Paul said that a couple of times. I am not sufficient for these things, Paul would say. I don't have what it takes to do this. But my sufficiency is what? From the Lord. And you see, as we begin to see the way God sees us, then we're able to correct that situation. Galatians 6, 3, for if a man thinks himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. James 4, 6 to 10 as well. Since this is true, we all need accountability, restraints, discipline. I think we can make it if you hold on here a minute. How much more than do our children be ready to deal with your children's sinful nature? Here's some unbiblical solutions we can look at pretty quickly. Behaviorism. What is behaviorism? What?
Study of behavior?
No. Behaviorism as far as an approach to taking care of your child's total depravity. Otherwise, you are so strict, so tight, that they not dare misbehave, but you haven't touched their heart. All you've done is got them to do the right thing. That's not going to work. The heart must be our focus, not simply what they do. How many of you have seen your children do what you've said, but in a wrong way? I've said that's not really obedience. Just because you've cleaned the room, I didn't add go and shout and scream and rebel the whole time you're doing it. But I obeyed. No, you didn't. We must enforce biblical behavior patterns, but these alone do not resolve the issue of depravity. That's the heart. Isolationism is the second one. Building a cocoon around our children, isolating them, thinking that if I take them out of the world completely, that is going to, and not letting them be resolved or be influenced at all, that's going to make them very simple, very naive. Boy, Proverbs has a whole list of things. How long, O naive ones, will having been simple-minded, the waywardness of the naive will kill them, and the complacency of fools and destroy them, on and on and on. We must cultivate a kind of holy innocence in our children and ourselves. There's a difference of being naive and being inexperienced. Being naive, thinking, oh, they're all right. No, being inexperienced, because even Paul made a comment, it's okay to be inexperienced when it comes to evil, but be mature when it comes to, godliness. But we must point out at times, that is bad behavior. That is wrong. And we must prepare our children for those influences upon their lives. What are you going to do if your friend wants you to do this? Prepare them to do that. And then the third one, quickly, self-esteem. Boy, that's a huge one today. If I just get my child to love himself, and to think great about himself, that will take care of the total depravity. No, it'll worsen it 10 times. Never in Scripture, experts tell us, improving our child's self-esteem will resolve your child's psychological, emotional problems. Never are we commanded in Scripture to love ourselves. Now, people want to take one verse, love one another as You love yourself. Oh, there it is. There's the command. No, no, no. The idea is you are to love others as you already love yourself. I love Ephesians 5, the marriage chapter. It says to fathers, husbands, to love their wives as their own what? Bodies. No one has ever hated themselves. Well, I've heard a lot of people say, I hate myself so much, I'm going to do this, that, or the other. No, that's a false pride. They hate themselves because they think they deserve this. And they're focused on themselves and what they don't have. It's a reverse self-focus that has a very negative impact. Never are we commanded to have a healthy self-image. We are commanded to have an image that what? Reflects Christ. We're to be molded and shaped and formed not into our self-image, but into what? The image of God's Son. I've often said you can have your self-image. Boy, when I think of what I am in Christ. Quite the contrary. And in conclusion, four things here. How to have a biblical self-image. I believe there is a biblical self-image. Self-image is basically how do we see ourselves. The first step is, as we saw earlier, see yourselves as God sees us. Start there. That's the foundation with that total depravity. Secondly, see yourselves as God's creation. God created you. You're His. And at creation, of course, man sinned, and therefore sin came in, and that's why God sees us now as He does. But what does He do at salvation? Remember? Any man that be in Christ, he is what? New creation. So see yourself as being cleaned up, washed, recreated, if you may, as a new creation. See yourselves as God sees us, as a fallen, total, depraved person. But secondly, see yourself as God's creation. Thirdly, see yourselves as God's servant. You're God's servant to serve Him. And then see yourselves with God's potential. Remember Ephesians 3, He will do abundantly above all that we ask or think. See yourself with God's potential. This is the biblical self-image that you must instill into your children. And the solution, the last two things there, for your child's depravity, what is the solution, class? Come on, you know it. What is the solution to your child's depravity? Pardon? All right, salvation, regeneration, Titus 3:5. Praying for that day and going for that day that your child recognizes their depravity, recognizes their sin, and wants Jesus to come in and forgive them and save them. And then secondly, it's called simply discipleship. Ephesians 6:4, that's what parenting is all about that we mentioned. 1 Thessalonians 2:11, we talked about that men's breakfast the other day. Deuteronomy 6:6-9, teaching and training our children. Planters of shade trees, viewing parenting. Children, a blessing from God given to us. Parenting should be considered a joy because we have this awesome privilege and honor to take these little lives and mold them for God. You know, I've often said, regardless of what happens to me as a missionary or a pastor, if I can look at my children and see that they are producing themselves and their children, I'll die believing I was successful. What a privilege we have. What you do, how you respond, and how you teach and train. And making sure that your parental influence is more important than any other influence they're receiving. Your child's greatest need is regeneration and discipleship. Get these two things down. That's our foundation that MacArthur lays here. Then we get to work evangelizing our children, discipling our children, teaching our children, training our children, and showing them how to be parents. That's what we're going to from here. Any questions, comments that you have? Pardon? Oh, it's going to be, I just implore you to pray for one another. If you're not a parent, you don't have parents, children in your home, we need, and I often do, praying for those in our church family that still have parents at home. It's a chore. It's, as one parent said, it's the hardest job I've ever had. Yeah, not going to be always easy. Any other questions? Got it all down? Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you for caring for us. Thank you, Lord, for your word that is our instruction booklet. Help us, Lord, to be, as parents and grandparents, planters of shade trees for our children to draw upon and to find rest, to find encouragement as they become parents. Help us, Lord, to recognize truly what our child's greatest need is, and that is regeneration, to be saved, to be washed, to be recreated by you, and then to be growing in the fear and admonition of you. We ask it in thy precious name. Amen.